unusual.
A TJ Maxx manager tied up and threatened with a knife. The man who did it ran off with a bag of cash from the store.
And right now, Menor police are still looking for him. They told me today they hope you recognize him.
This is the man who tied the woman managing this TJ Maxx up by her wrists after threatening her with a knife so he could clear out their safe. An Ohio State hoodie pulled up, a black scarf covering most of his face.
It's very unusual to have an aggravated robbery.
He made off with a bag filled with cash.
They're going to do an audit of that safe and we'll find out exactly what was in there.
So based on what you saw, it looked like they...
I talked to a witness over the phone who didn't want to be identified, but told me he knew something was wrong the minute the man entered the store, just by how he was dressed. He said there wasn't a loud scene or commotion, but some employees responded strangely, refusing to look at him. I asked police about that.
What's the likelihood this was an inside job?
We always look at that, but I couldn't tell you right now. I mean, there's lots of different motives.
Telling me they're investigating every possible angle, exploring every lead while in the early stages of this investigation, but they hope you at home can help.
If anybody saw anything around that time, especially a male that would match that description that has a Ohio State jacket on and his hood up, if he was getting a ride or if somebody was in the parking lot with him, that's information that we could really use.
Now, I reached out to the manager of that store. She hasn't responded to my request for comment, so we're choosing not to share her name right now. But Mentor Police told me there was a similar incident recently in Willoughby, and that's part of this investigation. Just into the now Cleveland, accused serial killer Sean Great has pleaded not guilty by reason of insanity. In connection with the murders of these two women in Ashland County, Great could receive the death penalty for life without the possibility of parole if convicted. He's due back in court January 6th. Great has confessed to killing three other women, but those cases are still under investigation.
The Catholic Diocese of Cleveland confirming its bishop is stepping down. Bishop Richard Lennon making his announcement at a news conference today. Dominic Ricks has been following this story. Dominic, we're told the bishop's health is in decline.
Rob, he made his health conditions public today, saying he was recently diagnosed with vascular dementia, a disease that causes memory loss. He went on to say, given the nature of his illness, his request to Pope Francis back in November for early retirement was accepted. Lennon was 69 years old. The mandatory age for retirement for bishops in the United States is actually 75. The news of his illness does not come as a surprise. Earlier this year, Lennon underwent heart surgery. He had kind words to say about members of the diocese.
I have had the great privilege of serving with these wonderful people in our diocese. I also wish to express my love for the faithful of this great diocese.
Lennon's request became effective at 6 a.m. today. Bishop Daniel Edward Thomas of Toledo will fill the role until the Pope selects a new bishop. Lennon faced a lot of criticism in his early years in that position because he wanted to consolidate churches due to declining membership. He was named the 10th Bishop of Cleveland in 2006. Live in the studio, Dominique Ricks, News 5.
A special delivery for two Canton Police canine officers, both receiving brand new body armor. You can see Diesel and Tuco sporting their new bullet and stab-proof vests. Those vests were donated by a local nonprofit. They're embroidered with the words, "In memory of canine Jethro." Now, you might remember Jethro was shot and killed last January during a robbery in Canton.
Right now, security at shopping malls across the country is on high alert after more than a dozen disturbances, including this one at Beechwood Place that happened Monday. Now, last night, more mayhem in at least 9 states. Elizabeth Herr tells us police confirmed social media helped fuel these panics.
More chaos and confusion at shopping malls. Just a day after more than a dozen disturbances were reported in malls across the country.
First, I thought it wasn't really real because we've had alarms go off and stuff.
Police in Appleton, Wisconsin had to evacuate the Fox River Mall Tuesday night over a report of a person with a gun.
I was kind of freaking out. I was like, what's going on? You know, something this big has never happened before.
That person was never found, but police say they're still investigating. Meanwhile, in Pennsylvania.
They were running around. They were shouting, yelling, screaming.
Police say they had to break up a large fight inside the food court of the Philadelphia Mills Mall.
These teenagers, these juveniles were able to get on social media, specifically Snapchat, and they were able to all meet up at this location.
In Aurora, Colorado on Monday, dozens of officers responded to another fight inside a mall food court, this involving as many as 500 people. Authorities say they don't know yet if all the incidents are related, but do believe social media posts promoting fights at the malls sparked some of these brawls.
In response, malls across the country are stepping up security, and some are even implementing a new policy preventing kids from shopping without adults. Elizabeth Herr, ABC News, New York.
The Ohio House officially on winter break now. They've adjourned for the year, and that eliminates the possibility lawmakers would try to override Governor Kasich's vetoes on a controversial abortion bill and a renewable energy bill. And now we take a first look at our weather. Hello, Mark Johnson.
Sir, Mr. Rob Powers, our big weather headline, waiting for snow. Yeah, we've got some snow moving our way, but right now we are dry in the Power 5. But you notice here we got a couple of counties that are lit up in blue. A lake effect snow watch, not right now, not tonight, kicks in Thursday evening at 6 p.m. through at least Friday midnight, probably early Saturday morning for Geauga and inland Ashtabula County south of Interstate 90. Notice northern Ashtabula, Lake County, Cuyahoga not included as of now in the watch. There could be a squall or two in that zone, which could dump anywhere from 4 to 8 inches of snow in a couple of spots where squalls persist. You've heard that before. In the meantime, let me show you your future cast. No worries about inclement weather through your evening hours. We're in the 30s right now. We've got a lot of sunshine right now. Notice clouds, though, begin to creep in as we head toward 8 o'clock. And there you have it. Bedtime, 11 p.m., the snow begins to move in from the west. It's already in Sandusky, Mansfield, Elyria, and knocking on the door of Medina and Greater Cleveland by 11 p.m. May mix in a few raindrops or a little bit of sleet. But still, an inch or two of new snow overnight tonight, a good possibility for many of us. More on that coming up.
With overtime laws at a standstill, some businesses are stuck with the changes they made to be in compliance. I'm Kumasi Aaron. What's next for them and their employees?
And back here at home, let's take a live look outside right now. This is what's happening on your roads. Everything looks smooth right now. Thanks for watching, everybody. This is the Now Cleveland, and we're back in 3 minutes. We have new video into the now Cleveland dive crews are recovering the second black box from a Russian airplane that crashed into the Black Sea Christmas Day. Investigators hope the cockpit voice recording will tell them why that plane went down shortly after takeoff. It had just refueled when it crashed. All 92 people on board died. Investigators have ruled out terrorism. We could find out later this week how the U.S. will respond to Russia for hacking into the election process. The Obama administration's reportedly finalizing its plans right now. Sources tell the Washington Post they are expected to include economic sanctions against Russia and diplomatic censure as well. They could also include some type of covert cyber operation. Russia's denied any involvement in the hacking, but the U.S. says it has proof that country was involved in trying to disrupt our election.
Secretary of State John Kerry is defending the United States' decision to abstain from a UN resolution condemning Israeli settlements in the West Bank and Jerusalem. He says the U.S. had no part in drafting that resolution. According to Kerry, a two-state solution allowing both Israel and Palestine is the only option to achieve peace.
It is the only way to ensure Israel's future as a Jewish and democratic state, living in peace and security with its neighbors. It is the only way to ensure a future freedom and dignity for the Palestinian people, and it is an important way of advancing United States interests in the region.
With less than a month left in office, Kerry says no one has done more for Israel's security than the Obama administration, and that the United States has consistently supported Israel's right to defend itself. But John Kerry isn't the only politician weighing in. Before his speech today, President-elect Donald Trump tweeted, quote, "We cannot continue to let Israel be treated with such total disdain and disrespect. They used to have a great friend in the U.S., but not anymore. Stay strong, Israel. January 20th is fast approaching." That's when Trump will be inaugurated as the next president. Israel's prime minister responded to Trump, thanking him for his support, but also said, quote, "We don't need to be lectured by foreign leaders." We will stay on top of this and keep you updated on all developments.
Well, President-elect Trump also tweeting about his relationship with President Obama, and it appears things aren't so rosy. Trump tweeted, "Doing my best to disregard many inflammatory President O statements and roadblocks. Thought it was going to be a smooth transition. Not." Earlier this week, President Obama said he thinks he could have beaten Trump in the election if he had been allowed to run again. Just in, convicted killer Dylan Roof will not try to avoid the death penalty when he is sentenced next month. Roof told the judge today he'll act as his own attorney and will not present any evidence to convince jurors to sentence him to life in prison instead. Earlier this month, that same jury convicted Roof of killing 9 parishioners at a church in South Carolina in June of 2015.
You may remember the controversy with the FBI wanting to access an Apple iPhone after the San Bernardino shootings. Well, now another digital privacy case is making headlines, this time with the Amazon Echo. Police in Arkansas want to get digital recordings from the Amazon Echo that was inside this home where a man was found murdered last year. They think the device may have recordings of the moments leading up to that death, but the defendant's attorney says technology is not infallible and says police are relying on it too heavily.
Should things be said out of context, that scares me. And it scares me that our criminal system is coming down to this technology, which is supposed to help our daily lives, and now it's being used against us for an innocent client.
Amazon did hand over Bates' account details, but so far, Amazon has declined to give police the voice recordings.
A man is dead after police say he ran along a highway naked and started banging his head against a car. Police in Tampa say that man approached this silver car, eventually cracking the windshield with his head. And that's when police were called in.
He was behaving as if he were on some sort of mind-altering. I don't know what it would be at this point. That's another thing that we need to investigate.
Well, that man was placed in a police car where he were told he continued to fight with officers. He then had some sort of medical emergency.
Controversy surrounding a Boy Scout troop in New Jersey. An 8-year-old boy was reportedly kicked out of his troop because he is transgender. Now he's known Jody, known as Joe, signed up for Cub Scouts earlier this year. His mother says she made it very clear he was transgender,
But after about a month, she said she got a call from the Boy Scouts head counsel saying he could no longer be a part of the organization.
And I felt bad for my son because he was having a good time. They had a barbecue. Mm-hmm. The last day they had a Halloween party. They did experiments. He really enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. And he was with all his friends.
The Boy Scouts of America endured years of controversy before ultimately lifting bans on gay scouts and leaders in recent years. But a spokesperson says the organization considers transgender children a separate issue.
Here on The Now, we've told you about a judge halting a new rule that would have made millions of Americans eligible for overtime pay. But The Now's Kumasi Aaron has found out some businesses and their employees are still feeling its effects.
At 2WR Plus Partners, this small team of employees is more like a family.
Where you working, huh?
That's why when a judge delayed a new overtime law days before it was set to go into effect, partner Sam Andre said he couldn't just take back pay increases they'd already received.
You definitely can't say, sorry, can we get a refund? hey guys, can we take back that raise?
Andre's architectural firm gave the raises to accommodate the new law, which would have made workers earning less than around $47,000 eligible for overtime pay. Meeting that threshold cost the firm.
For our business, it was about $75,000. And, you know, when you think about it, that's, in Georgia, that's a young architect and an intern. That's two positions.
Legally, Andre's firm can reverse the changes, but he says the negative morale just isn't worth it. It's a decision other businesses are making, too.
It seems like most people are sticking with, we're just going to keep it.
Mark Cicatello worked with companies in Arizona, Utah, Colorado, and Wyoming ahead of the change. He says with the judge's ruling and subsequent delay, most are staying the course.
57% of our members actually went ahead and implemented the change. Now, of those 57% that implemented, 78% said they were going to go ahead and keep the changes that they had already made.
Big name companies like Kroger, Walmart, and Wendy's are sticking with the changes they made as well. While employee salaries have changed, Andre says the firm's income hasn't, and they don't plan on asking customers to pay more. Still, he believes some things matter more than the money.
We have employees who are 100% committed to us, and we give that same commitment back to them.
For The Now, I'm Kumasi Aaron.
Well, the Labor Department has appealed that judge's order to halt the overtime law. Right now, though, it's not clear if the department will move forward with that case after President-elect Trump takes office.
Take a look at this. A guy in North Dakota decided to test out just how deep he could go in a snowdrift that had piled up outside his house. You can see that blizzard snow almost covers his head. More than 16 inches fell in parts of North Dakota over Christmas. The storm shut down roads and left thousands of people without power. But this guy, safe to say, he's making the best of it.
Okay, snow there, and if you look behind us, sun in downtown Cleveland
right
now. Isn't
she gorgeous?
Looking good right now.
Looking good now.
I'd be happy if it stayed that way for a little longer.
Are we getting 16 inches?
No. 16 inches, maybe an inch to two overnight tonight. But right now, look, we're dry here. Worcester, sunshine. We are looking west over Worcester High School, and you can see the cloud bank beginning to creep our way. This is west. This is, of course, east. So it's moving west to east in. Clouds will begin to thicken up. But not for a little while. Currently, Cleveland 41 with some sunshine, Mansfield 39, Worcester at 39 with a feels like temp of 33 with winds out of the south anywhere from 5 to 15 miles per hour. Akron currently 39 degrees. Okay, there you have it. Temps near 40 degrees, right where we thought we would be this time of year. Let me show you your snow chances though. Yeah, we are going to get snow. Your evening looks good, 7 p.m. Now notice by 10 p.m. we're beginning to increase that into the good category, your snow chance. And we peak with the snow right around 1 a.m. So between 10 p.m. and about 2 or 3 in the morning, that's your best window for snow overnight tonight. And again, we're going to go with generally 1 to 2 inches of snowfall, maybe a couple of spots getting a little more. But it's an area-wide snow. Maybe a raindrop mixing in as well, as temps will stay mild. 39 degrees at 5 p.m., 7 p.m. We're in the mid-30s still, so we're still above freezing. Same for 10 p.m., and we'll begin to watch that snow as of 10 p.m. moving in from the west. I still think by 10, Cleveland, Akron, and Canton will be dry, but Sandusky, Norwalk, maybe Mansfield, you'll begin to see that snow moving in after 10 p.m. And then by 11:30 tonight, Cleveland, you get some snow, all right? A little rain mixing in. Overnight tonight, here we go, a low near 32, Medina 33, 32 for Akron. Snow, a trace to 2 inches, maybe a little bit of rain mixing in tonight. So, Rob, put the top up on the Jeep. You don't want rain and snow on those front seats as you get ready to go home after News 5 at 11.
I already put the screws in.
There you
go.
It's
not coming out until the spring.
You know he's always prepared.
Thinking
about bettering your bank account for the new year?
Well, next on The Now Cleveland, we're going to share some money-saving resolutions you may want to make before the ball drops. A reminder that you are watching The Now Cleveland. Hey, where are you going?
Come back.
Well, it is time to ring in the new year with some more cash. According to Fidelity's financial resolution study, the three most common money-related goals for 2017 are to save money, pay down debt, and spend less. To keep those resolutions, experts recommend setting up an automatic savings account. Every time you get paid, a little bit goes into savings. Get rid of debt, you pay off the balance of the card with the highest interest rate first, and to spend less, put together a budget, check those statements, make sure you know how much you spend on what. Sticking with the money now, that jar of pennies you have stashed somewhere, that could one day become a collector's item.
But not for their value, but because those pennies, it may be a matter of time before the U.S. stops making them.
No.
It's already costing more to make the penny than it's worth. And that cost is going up for the first time in 5 years. The U.S. Mint says this year it will cost 1.5 cents to make each 1 cent coin. And the Wall Street Journal is reporting that's the first time costs have gone up since 2011.
The mint's changed what pennies are made out of to try to cut down costs. The penny is now 2.5% copper. The rest is zinc. From 1962 to 1982, it was the opposite, 95% copper, 5% zinc. A recent congressional report concluded there is no cheaper way to make a penny, but to get rid of it altogether, Congress would have to pass a new law.
So let's count coins. In the 2015 fiscal year, the mint made just more than 9 billion pennies. That compares to 1.5 billion nickels, nearly 3 billion dimes, and nearly 3 billion quarters. That's more pennies than all the other coins combined. But on a positive note, the mint says it usually makes more money off quarters and dimes.
Okay, I've got at least that much in little pickle jars and, you know, back in the back of the closet somewhere.
I can't see the penny go. I mean, I get...
Can you say nickel for your thoughts? Inflation coming up here. Still ahead for us on the Now Cleveland.
Passengers flying from Florida to Cleveland were delayed, diverted, and then put on a bus. But you might not believe this. It could have been worse.
And weather-wise, a big circle. We're watching for rain and sleet and snow right here to develop and move our way. We'll time it in hour by hour coming up.
I know, right? Yes, what's in my pocket? Oh, I got a card. I got one. I got you. Test 1, 2. Hello, hello, hello. We're working on it. Yeah.
Hi, mic check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Gotta love going to the wrong happy dog. Check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Mic check.
Look at you drinking your hot tea over here.
Hot tea keeps the voice kind of lubricated. Uh-huh. Gets a little squeaky when I'm in here. Who knows what's falling down from the ceiling? All right. It's that kind of time of year. Dry air, you know.
Just the tea with the honey sounds good.
Tea, yeah, that'll warm me right up.
Tea right here. You got the little honey bear. We
I'm
do honey shots.
Yeah.
You're looking.
It looks good. Go do your thing. I'm going to take a sip.
All right, let's talk about what's going on weather-wise. My singing voice is back, by the way. Here we go. We're going to watch. We've got two little fronts. We've got a front here and a front here, and moisture is going to pool together here during the next 4 hours or so. We'll begin to see more rain and snow beginning to develop. Already seeing some right there, okay? And then that's going to move our way, and it will arrive most likely after 11 p.m. So you've got a while before you have to deal with rain, sleet, or snow. Currently downtown, 41, 37 Parma, 39 Bedford, 36 in Orange, 40 North Royalton to Brunswick, 40 in Westlake now. In the Akron-Canton area, 40 in Akron, 39 Massillon, Canton, Jackson, Kent, and Alliance sitting at 38. So you're hour by hour, 5 p.m., partly cloudy, you're dry. 39 to 40, 37 at 7, a few more clouds. You notice at 11 p.m., we have some raindrops, but I'm thinking we're going to have snow, too. So snow, generally an inch or two overnight tonight, and with a little bit of rain mixing in at times as temps hover through 1 a.m. in the mid-30s. Rob, Tara, take it away.
A direct flight from South Florida to Cleveland was anything but direct for a group of Spirit Airlines customers. We first told you about this yesterday on the Now. Delays followed by a diversion, and then everyone was told they were getting on a bus. That bus broke down. Could it have been any worse? Well, apparently so. The Now's Derek Waller has brand new information today. Derek, these poor people, what is going on now?
Well, Sarah, I spoke with another passenger on that doomed flight and an airline industry expert who says this really wasn't as bad as it could have been. Flight 440 from Fort Lauderdale to Cleveland was scheduled to land at 5:10 on Monday night, but some passengers didn't arrive until sometime around 4 or 5 a.m. Tuesday. Delayed, then diverted to Detroit because of high wind. The crew ran out of flight time, so Spirit put everyone on buses, one of which broke down. Spirit offered everyone $50 vouchers, and an airline industry expert says they didn't even have to do that. Stan Kovac and his wife were on that flight for their anniversary.
Unfortunately, it's going to always be remembered as that plane flight from hell back home rather than our 45th anniversary cruise.
I'm actually shocked that they even did that. This $50 voucher and the fact that they rented these buses, that's kind of a big deal, because if this had happened a year ago, those people would not have even got any of that.
Yes, she says that's because Spirit is actually trying to make some steps to improve their customer service, and Spirit did tell me over the phone they blame this perfect storm of events on bad weather. Live at the airport, Derek Waller, News 5.
All right, Derek, thank you very much. We've got an update now on another story we told you about yesterday on the Now. A special set of bagpipes stolen from an Ohio Honor Guard member has been found. This was Stephen Watt yesterday playing on a borrowed set of pipes. The instrument he usually uses at police funerals was stolen right from inside his car. But thanks to an alert postal worker, those pipes were found on the side of a highway in Kentucky last night. Watt's uniform, some other mementos, those are still missing.
A furious and irate Starbucks customer took her anger out on employees, and of course, cameras were rolling. Take a look. Coffee bags all over the place. A whole row of baskets just thrown on the floor. A five-tier shelf pushed over. Florida police say the woman demanded baristas for change to get on the bus, and when they refused, she just lost it.
The lady had no regard whatsoever. As she started shoving over displays, she actually pushed one into my daughter, who wasn't injured, but for a 7-year-old who sees screaming and things being thrown around the store, she was very scared.
That woman now faces multiple charges, including criminal mischief, marijuana possession, and trespassing. Turns out it was the second day in a row that Starbucks threw her out.
Right now, artists in Northeast Ohio are up in arms after learning controversial changes could be coming to the way they receive public funding. The Now's Mike Brookbank joining us live from Cleveland. Mike, some of Cleveland's more creative minds meeting just to voice their concerns.
Yeah, they are. At this hour, they are here at the Happy Dog at Euclid Tavern, and some of these artists tell me that they are worried about the future of community-level artwork here in Cleveland.
The concern stems from the Cuyahoga Arts and Culture's decision to end its current individual artist grant program. Every year, the public agency distributes $15 to $16 million of money collected from the cigarette tax to the arts in Northeast Ohio. 2% of it goes to local artists to support their work in the community. But now, the CAC wants to make sure that work connects with taxpayers, something the agency says their old program didn't achieve. Laura Dumm and her husband received a grant back in 2013 to complete this mural in Ohio City. She says under new ideas being tossed around by the CAC, in order to get that money now, she'd have to take time away from her art to learn how to give back to a community that she has already served for decades.
That 2% should just be to let artists be artists. I think it's going to discourage a lot of artists.
Now, the director of Cuyahoga Arts and Culture tells News 5 they don't want to stifle the work of local artists. In fact, they are committed to making sure they have a place at the table as they craft this new program moving forward, a program that should be in place in mid-2017. For now, we are live in Cleveland's Uptown neighborhood. Mike Brookbank, News 5.
Right now, the National Highway Safety Traffic Administration is looking into reports of braking problems with certain Ford Fusions and Mercury Milans. The investigation covers vehicles made between 2007 and 2009, and U.S. safety regulators have received nearly 150 complaints about the issue. Some drivers say they've blown through red lights or passed stop signs before being able to stop their vehicles, and at least three crashes have been inked to the problem. We all know getting stuck at a ton of red lights is a real bummer. So take a look at this Manhattan Uber driver's epic streak with none of them. Noah Foreman started his journey in Harlem and hit 240 consecutive green lights.
What? No way.
Crazy. He drove for nearly 30 minutes before he hit a red light.
I used to drive that going uptown, and no way. I maybe hit three.
No, for me, it's the opposite. I hit every red light.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sure. That's just the way it is. Now, even though winter just started, some of us are already thinking about summer vacations.
But should you book your next escape now or should you wait? We're breaking down the best dates to fly next year and when tickets will be the cheapest.
The beach, the sun, not this weekend. Take a look. Our last weekend of the year, our last Saturday of the year, and the beginning of 2017. We got snow coming in, could mix with a little bit of rain. Whoops, we got a little, there we go. 37 degrees for the high, and then Sunday should be dry but cloudy as we welcome in 2017. 34 degrees for the high. Rob, did you find that interesting?
I did, I'm just looking at you.
These boys.
Nice. Right back with more than that now. That afternoon. What happened?
even though we are still in the midst of the holiday travel season, it is never too early to start looking ahead to your next getaway. Right, Rob?
Never. Right now, we're getting a hint now as to when you can make the most of your money in this coming year. Fair Compare has been breaking down those deals, so get out the planner. If you want to take a trip this winter, the best time to fly is between January 7th and March 5th. Now, there's one exception, the time between February 11th and the 24th. Now, let's go to spring. Fly by April 1st. After that, prices are expected to go up the following 2 weeks. For summer, fly by June 9th. There could be a price increase around June 3rd. Peak summer pricing begins around June 20th.
Now, it's a lot to remember, but Fair Compare says overall, January through March usually has the cheapest prices of the year. That's because airfare drops after the busy holiday season. So if you want to plan a trip to Europe, Fair Compare says fall and winter are usually the cheapest dates to go, but it's expecting historically low tickets to some parts of Europe this summer as well. One final note, Fair Compare says no matter what, always shop around and compare prices just to make sure you're getting the very best deal.
A lot of information right there.
Now, one of the most popular toys of the holiday season is leaving some kids and their parents very disappointed. We're looking into complaints about Hatchimals not hatching and what the toy maker is doing about it. That is a mouthful of a toy.
Hatchimals. What are Hatchimals if they don't hatch? You are watching the Now Cleveland. Look at that. Look at the beauty on this day. That is something right there. The Now's back in a bit. We've been telling you about random acts of kindness this holiday season, but one man's on a personal mission to make a difference the entire year.
The Now's national photojournalist Isaac Blancas is taking us to Colorado Springs, where one man is working to sock it to him.
I love Colorado Springs. It's been very good to me, and I want to be good to it.
You're welcome, brother. Have a great day. Merry Christmas.
I go out to the streets two or three times a week. Do you like a pair of socks? I'm handing out about 250 pair of socks a week, one pair per person. Socks? We have over 1,000 homeless people out here. I'm the sock guy. Have you heard about me?
Yeah, I think you helped me a pair last month. Once your socks are wet, then they just freeze. You gotta have a pair of socks changed into. I went to the hospital, my toes are still swelled up and red. I think it was close to frostbite.
A basic need is taking care of your feet. You're on your feet all day if you're on the streets.
They're thin, they have no insulation, they're just rubber.
Yes, sir, thank you, brother.
You're welcome.
Yeah, you gotta keep them rotated, you gotta keep them dry.
I have met some out here that have shown me what it is to not have socks and dry socks, and they've lost digits. They've got a few toes missing. Would you like a pair of socks, young lady?
Oh, you know it. Thank you. I just stepped in a huge puddle. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Yeah. been on the streets off and on from the time I was 14 until I was 39. Off and on with my addictions, battling my addictions, being homeless. Do you like a pair of socks? Socks is one of the things that people need the most. Do you like a pair of socks? But it's the least donated item by the general public, by people, because people never think about it. Like a pair of socks?
Sure.
You can have a dirty pair of pants and wear them for a week. It's not very healthy for your feet to wear a dirty pair of socks for a week. Merry Christmas.
You have nowhere to wash them. And you have to throw them away.
So a dry, clean pair of socks every day is very important. You're welcome. Hey, you have big feet? You want a size 12 through 15? Would that fit you better? I do this all year. I'm out here every week. It's a small act of kindness and a small act of love. Do you like a pair of socks?
John estimates he personally hands out more than 13,000 pairs of socks every year. If you want to learn more about his program, head to the News 5 app.
That is something. Now to story of a son giving his mother the ultimate gift for Christmas, a new chance at life. Colin Hambrook of Baltimore donated half of his own liver to his mom. She'd been struggling with liver disease for years.
He said, "Mom, I'm going to be your Christmas present." And that was just, I broke down.
How about that? The transplant was a total success. Doctors say in just a few months, both of their livers will fully regenerate.
What a great story. Now, the item at the top of so many Christmas lists isn't all it's cracked up to be. At least that's what some parents are saying. Parents across the country say their kids' Hatchimals will not hatch. You're supposed to rub, tap, or knock on the shell for about 30 minutes before it hatches. But they say they are rubbing, tapping, and knocking, and it is just not working. Customers are firing back at the company on social media, venting about how unhappy they are. Others complaining about being on hold for hours when they called customer care, calling Christmas's hottest toy a total dud.
But half the fun is the hatching process from the hatch and molt. If we manually hatched it, the beak would never pop out.
The company makes Hatchimals Spin Master. That's the company that makes them. It's now addressing the issue on its website, saying they've hired more customer care workers and extended hours for callers. They've also posted a video with tips on how to get the toy to hatch. But the company will still not say why the toys aren't hatching or how many are affected. You love this story.
I'm sorry.
He can't stop
the famous New Year's Eve ball in Times Square getting a makeover before its big drop. This year's ball features a new crystal design. It's called the Gift of Kindness. It symbolizes unity. 12 feet in diameter, weighs more than 11,000 pounds. The Times Square ball has been redesigned a number of times over the years.
It's amazing to think that the celebrations began in 1907 when the ball was just a couple of pounds in weight with 100 screw-in light bulbs. And look where we are today, 32,000 LEDs.
An estimated 1 million people are expected to gather in Times Square Saturday night to watch the ball drop. I'm afraid to go to Mark right now. He loves that Hatchimal story.
He's
as much
created his own Hatchimal.
My Hatchimal is not hatching either. What do you think the problem is?
It's not a Hatchimal.
It's not? What is? Oh, it's a pumpkin. It's that might be the problem.
That could be the problem.
Maybe it didn't get a Hatchimal after all.
It's just a mole.
It's just a mole. Here we have Cleveland at 41 degrees. We're beginning to see some clouds moving in. Akron's at 39. Ashtabula, Ravenna. Look at all this clear sky action here with temps 30s to near 40. Dover, New Philly at 41 degrees. So all in all, seasonable to a couple of degrees above the norm for late December. Here's what we have going on. We got a little front right here and another little front there. Two low pressure areas. They're going to combine their strengths a little bit, stir up some moisture in the form of primarily snow, may get a little rain mixing in. In fact, here's the area already developing. I drew a little circle earlier in the now right here as to where we were expecting to see precip, and there it is. Right now it is rain, but by the time it reaches us, I think we're going to see mainly snow. There's low pressure number one and two, and again, they ride in with some snow. We'll go with a trace to 2 inches of snow overnight tonight. Here we have it, our snowfall cast through 7:45 a.m. Cleveland about an inch, same for Mentor. Canton, Ravenna, an inch and a half to two. Worcester, not even quite an inch. But again, it's enough to notice, enough to have to scrape off the windshields. but not enough to really slow you down too much, except the roadways will become a little bit wet, slippery, untreated surfaces, so be careful. Mid-30s by midnight tonight. Rain mixing with snow here, and again, this shows a lot of rain, but I'm thinking mainly snow. And notice temps in the lower and middle 30s in Akron and Canton by midnight tonight. I'm selling this Hatchimal. Anybody want it?
No one wants it.
Not over here. Our newsroom hard at work right now getting ready for News 5 at 5.
Frank Wiley's joining us right now with a preview. Hey, Frank, what's going on?
Hey, what's up there, guys? We're following this. New details about that chaotic scene that played out in Beechwood Mall. One of the busiest shopping days, too, is when it all happened. What is the psychology behind that event? And safety regulators, they are now investigating one of the largest automakers in the country. They're looking into some braking problems. We're going to tell you the makes and models, those stories and more tonight on News 5 at 5.
We have breaking news right now into the now. Actress Debbie Reynolds has been rushed to the hospital after suffering some sort of medical emergency. According to TMZ, Debbie was at her son's home in Beverly Hills. Someone there called 911. Debbie's daughter, of course, actress Carrie Fisher, passed away yesterday.
And right now, tributes continue to pour in for Carrie Fisher. Today, Fisher is being remembered for that legacy that stretches far beyond the role that catapulted her to superstardom. Elizabeth Herr has more.
The legendary role of Princess Leia.
You're braver than I thought.
May have defined her career.
May the force be with you.
But Carrie Fisher was a star in her own right, starring in dozens of movies and TV shows, writing books, and sharing with the world her struggles with bipolar disorder and addiction, telling ABC's Diane Sawyer it was her mental illness that fueled her drug abuse.
I am mentally ill. I can say that. I am not ashamed of that. I survived that.
So many people are now coming out about their bipolar disorder. And it's a beautiful legacy. The fact that she was so honest about mental illness is just incredible.
It's a battle she chronicled in her semi-autobiographical novel, Postcards from the Edge, turned into a movie. And Fisher's best-selling novel, Wishful Drinking, later became a celebrated one-woman show on HBO.
While the place I've arrived at in my life isn't precisely everyone's idea of heaven, I could swear sometimes, if I'm quiet enough, I can hear the angels sing.
Fisher's funeral arrangements are still being finalized. We're told her daughter is handling those plans. Her brother, in the meantime, tells us expect her memorial service to be a celebration of her life because Carrie always liked a good party. Elizabeth Herr, ABC News, New York.
And now to a case of too much too soon. With the passing of Carrie Fisher, Cinnabon tweeted, "Rest in peace, you'll always have the best buns in the galaxy." The image is a nod to Fisher's distinctive cinnamon roll hairstyle she wore as Princess Leia in Star Wars. Social media, though, didn't take too kindly to this tweet, calling it tacky to promote the company. Others thought the late actress might have appreciated it. Either way, Cinnabon's now deleted this, saying it was genuinely meant as a tribute. We shouldn't have posted it. We are truly sorry. You know, we've lost a lot of celebrities this last year, and over the past few days, apparently there's a guy out there who just doesn't want another one.
No, he can't take another one, and he wants to make sure his favorite, the beloved Betty White, isn't next. He started a GoFundMe page to pay for him to stand guard over the beloved 94-year-old Golden Girls actress. So far, more than $2,400 has been raised. But in all seriousness, the man really plans to donate the proceeds to a local theater program. We're back after this.
New developments on accused serial killer Sean Great.
Sean, not so great.
No.
Daryl Creighton is the name of the man shot in front of a cafe on 4100 block.
Mall mayhem. News 5 learning new details about the chaotic scene.
roster. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Check 1, 2. Bring it down just a little bit. Bring it down a little bit. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Check 1, 2. Check, check, check. Okay.
Hey guys, this me.
What are we talking?
Test, test. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Virtual reality. Now this is cool. Imagine being transported off the ground or even out of this world, all while just hanging out in your doctor's office.
How about that? That's what one pediatrician's doing for his patients now to ease their fears about shots. The now Stephanie Suskind shows us how it all works.
All done. Not bad, right?
I just got the shot.
That's it. It's done.
Aww. 11-year-old Dylan Perlin just got a booster shot, and he didn't even know it.
It was really weird. Like, I felt like I was in outer space, or like between outer space and the Earth's atmosphere, and I felt nothing. I felt nothing. All I felt was cold and a buzzing, and then it was done.
That's because Dr. Chad Rudnick at VI Pediatrics in Boca Raton now uses virtual reality goggles to give patients what he calls the flinch-free vaccine experience.
And if we can reduce the level of anxiety and needle phobia or needle anxiety, then that's something that we want to do.
The goggles work with cell phone apps to transport your little boy or girl to another world.
I think we just landed on the ground.
Oh, there's a guy behind me.
Dr. Rudnick says kids get so immersed in what they're seeing, they don't notice that prick on their arm they were so afraid of. And he says the technology could go beyond pediatrics.
Using this technology may be able to make blood draws easier. It may be able to make just injections for other types of medications easier for an adult and for a child. So I think a lot of this is where technology and healthcare is moving.
And the doctor told me the idea actually came from one of his patients who brought his own goggles to the office.
So he put it on and he was on a roller coaster. And we went through the whole process and I gave him his shot and he didn't flinch. And his mom said, "Did that really happen?" And he said, "It's done." And he didn't feel it at all. And so a light bulb went off. And I said, "Wait a minute. Was that just once or is this really going to work?"
So far, it has. Dr. Rudnick has used the virtual reality goggles with about 2 dozen patients. And every time, it's successful, leaving Dylan with a thought few kids have while at the doctor's office.
Can I get another one?
Maybe next time, Dylan.
That's pushing it a little bit. Dr. Rudnick says he bought the virtual reality goggles online, about $100 each, and that virtual reality app is just a few dollars. Sign me up. That's it for the now.
We'll see you tomorrow at 4. News 5 starts right now.